Welcome back to the Simple Farmhouse Life podcast. One of my most popular episodes ever was episode 80, where I chatted with Abbie Halberstadt from MisforMama over on Instagram. She has 10 kids, two sets of twins. She and I are chatting again today. We're going to be talking overwhelm, priorities, how to get it all done, all of that good motherhood stuff, as well as just whatever else comes to mind. Abbie is super well-spoken. She just really has a way with language. She actually has a new book that I am so excited to read. It ships out on February 1st, so we're going to be chatting a little bit about that as well. My name is Lisa, mom of six and creator of the blog and YouTube channel Farmhouse on Boone. Join me as I share with you my love for creating a handmade home from scratch, cooking, and a little mom and entrepreneur life along the way.
So nice to chat with you again.
You too.
So when does your book officially, I know that it's available to order, but they're shipping soonish?
February 1st.
Okay. The point of the book is mediocre motherhood. We live in a culture where we're constantly bombarded with the whole hot mess thing. I know you talk a lot about that on your Instagram.
Yeah.
And there are days where we feel like that, but to accept that and kind of wallow in it is your message.
Right. So there are going to be people that are really irritated by the phrase mediocre motherhood. Like, how could any mother be described as mediocre given all that we do? And to some extent, I agree with that. We are constantly going from one thing to the next, changing hats all day long. But it's kind of our attitude that makes us mediocre. It's not what we're doing or even sometimes how we're doing it, though sometimes it is both of those things.
Yeah.
If we're completely honest, I mean, I know from day to day that I am more or less excellent in my choices based on how in tune I am with what the Lord's asking me to do today, or whether I've read my Bible that morning, or whether I've literally bit my tongue and not. But our attitude, if it's one of like, hey, motherhood stinks, you stink too, awesome. That kind of like defeatist attitude of let's all get down in the hole of how ridiculously hard and miserable this is, that I feel like is what makes it a mediocre experience. Not necessarily whether you make kombucha like Sally does or draw with your kids like, you know, Willow does, that kind of thing. So I think probably people will assume that it's a shaming book, or I mean, some people, a lot of people won't, especially if you're following my feed, because that's not my style, but they might assume that I'm out to get somebody in particular, but I'm not. I am like calling myself out on every page. And I feel like so much of what we call relatable is relatable because we all do it. But that's not necessarily a good thing.
Right. Yeah. Just because it happens doesn't mean we should all be like, well, let's just give up and celebrate it.
Exactly. Yes.
I was going to dive into some of the questions. I actually did a Q&A on my Instagram last week, and a lot of them were motherhood related. And I'm like, oh, I need to get Abbie back on as a mom of 10. I mean, I know that none of us have ever...
You're only a mom of seven. I mean, that doesn't
count. I know. I still feel like, I don't know. Like, I don't necessarily have, obviously, like I do, I almost have a teenager in like a week, but, I haven't been a mom that long. The most common questions, and I'm sure you probably get a lot about this too, is getting everything done. So just like, how do you homeschool, keep the house? A lot of people are also, I think we talked about this last time you were on, which was one of my most popular episodes, which is why I knew I had to have you back on.
Oh, that's awesome.
About spending individual time with each kid. I know a lot of people are really worried about that.
Sure.
But yeah, like what kind of stuff do you let go? Because none of us do get it all done.
No, we do not. That is a myth from the pit of Hades, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah.
So I think it's really important to know what your priorities are. So for me, priorities would be reading aloud to my kids as far as school goes, getting math and language arts done. We actually attend two co-ops, but that's only, and those are all day. And I am not at either one of those.
This I'm assuming is a very one's different... right now, which is why yeah, you said you yeah, could get on here.
Yeah, this is how this is happening. One is right now. And you want to know how I get this all done? People are like, just in case, how in the world is she on this podcast? I have a mother's helper 4 hours a week. And this is during her time. I scheduled it specifically
for the little ones, to be. Yeah.
So I have two babies. I have twin baby boys that are down for naps. Honor and Shiloh are 4 and 2. And they're with my mother's helper right now, who's going to play with them outside so you don't hear random screaming in the background. Uh-huh. And then she's going to come inside and do dishes while I answer emails and sign contracts and like order Christmas cards. I'm probably too late for that, if I'm honest. So priorities, huge. You know, what matters to me? I have a friend that I just talked to the other night, and I was thinking about her as I was looking at the questions that you sent me ahead of time. And she is one of the most just poised with it. Her house is always clean. Her children are kind. Like they're not just polite. They went out to your car and like, can I help you with your babies? You know, they're genuinely sweet.
I know
kiddos.
A family like that too.
Yeah. And I mean, she's intimidatingly together. And I know some people think of me that way. And I just want to go like, you need to see my laundry room right now in my bedroom because the downstairs is clean, but the upstairs, not so much. That's about priorities. We use the downstairs a lot more than we use the upstairs. I need the downstairs to be where I can find things and I'm not stepping on clutter constantly. So that is our priority, which means that if we have a really full week or four, like we've had recently, the upstairs stays more cluttered than the downstairs. We have a big house. And we chose that and we knew it would be a challenge to keep clean, even with all of us working together. But there are some things you have to let go. So you asked what I let go. My really smart, wise, ridiculously clean housed friend is like, I'm anal to the max. And so is my husband, which is how we keep things looking like this, because otherwise we'd go crazy. My sister works 3 part-time jobs, has 4 kids fewer, but is very artistic and has many ventures that she's kind of like got her fingers in all the time. And she's always trying to compare herself to me and my house. And I'm like, why in the world would you use my standards of what makes me crazy when it doesn't make you crazy?
Right.
So I feel like a good standard would be not slovenliness, of course, not just letting it go, but instead of looking over here and kind of veering off into this lane and smashing into somebody else, which is like literally an analogy that I use in the book. Uh-huh. It's not a bad thing to look at the make of the car and say, ooh, we might move up to a minivan next time, you know, if we're using this analogy. But it's a bad thing if you're looking so hard in the other lane that you literally crash into somebody because you're so upset they seem to be doing better or feeling so superior that obviously I would never do that kind of thing. So she was like, I just tell my sister all the time, what you're doing well. You know, now that's not always true. I'm not always doing what I'm doing well. I have to tweak things all the time. But I would say priorities for us in terms of homeschooling are your basics, getting them to co-op, reading aloud, Bible reading and memory. Like if we can get to those in the week, we've been successful in school and my kids are getting their homework done and we're turning it in. We're rocking along in school. And that's our goal. Sometimes we do extra stuff. Sometimes we do nature walks. Sometimes we do more history or we get into a different book or we do a lot of baking together, things like that, that are just kind of that every day. Oh, I see your cute little guy. I love that his name is Theo. I know, you know, I have a Theo that is precious. I love it.
Thank you.
And then, I think you'll probably ask me about this a little bit later, but our cleaning priorities are 2 times a day. We pick up throughout the day, but we have a morning routine and an evening routine.
Do you have like a set time and everybody jumps in and does it?
Yes. And everybody knows their jobs. Now, when I say set time, I don't mean it's like 9:15 we have to go. But just as soon as like we're done with breakfast and Bible reading, we know that it's morning routine time. So the wellness time may fluctuate by 30 or 45 minutes, depending on like if I've had an early morning class I had to teach or if we had co-op or whatever. Everybody knows their jobs. I feel like people make things too complicated with chores by trying to make things really fair. So they're like, oh, you have to rotate constantly. And we need to.
Oh, golly. Yeah. That's too much.
So I will tell you in our home, my 2 oldest are boys. They can cook, they can clean, they can change diapers. They can do all the things, but their main tasks in the mornings are dishes and the surrounding countertops to either side of the sink and the island, which we have a big 12 by 5 foot island.
Yeah.
So big space, clearing the island and sweeping around it. And they alternate those morning and night for a week at a time. And they are the ones that run that system.
Okay.
So if they come to me, I'm like, y'all can figure it out between you because you know, this is your thing. That's yours. Old enough. My twin girls who are 9 unload the dishwashers and do a downstairs sweep. Like they not sweeping, but picking up, putting things away.
Yeah.
My 10-year-old cleans the baby's high chairs, helps with the downstairs sweep, and like kind of keeps an eye on like putting all the pillows back on the couch, just so that everything is visually kind of back to reset. And then we don't clean bathrooms every day, but my girls clean the downstairs bathrooms. My 6-year-old takes we have a laundry basket at the bottom of the stairs, takes the laundry basket up to the laundry room, which is upstairs. And the toy area is this little half door under the stairs. People always call it our Harry Potter door because it's like this little half. All our toys go in there. They don't even necessarily go in neatly at all.
Right.
But they go in there.
Yeah.
They're put away. And he's in charge of keeping that clean and then putting away his Legos. And his 4-year-old brother helps and the 2-year-old causes havoc. Throws away diapers, that kind of thing. So that happens twice a day. Rain or shine. And that means that we have a reset twice a day. That's my house cleaning priority. I do a lot more than that throughout the week, especially on Mondays. I don't know if you've seen my Motivate Mama Mondays.
Yes.
But I have like basically Motivate Mama Monday. I don't have kids that day for co-op. I just have the babies. And I know for a lot of people, they say just have 1-year-old twin babies. You're kidding. That's like a lot. And it is, but they take good naps. And so I put ridiculous list and try to get as many things as I can done on Monday because I feel like it resets me for the entire week.
Right.
So that's kind of how those two things, Motivate Mom on Monday, like getting sweeping done, cleaning out the fridge, reorganizing the pantry, doing things my kids just, you know, don't like, they're not there yet kind of thing.
It needs a mom clean. I always am like, it needs a mom touch.
Exactly. And then those 2 cleaning times a day keep us sane.
Right. Yeah, I like the idea of the rhythm, not so much a regimented. I mean, some people that works for, but those kind of things totally stress me out. We have a similar routine. I guess I've never really thought about that we do it twice a day, but we kind of do. And everybody knows what they have to do. And kids can do a lot. They can completely do it and they can do it well too.
Yep.
And I think that's also like, I think sometimes parents feel bad almost. Like, I don't know why, because they contribute to the mess just as much as us, but we want our kids to not have to, I don't know, do hard things. Sometimes I feel like I ask them to do something. I almost am like, no, I do not feel bad. You do that. You know?
Yeah. Well, and you're absolutely right. And I mean, there are people that actually have the mindset that if kids do chores, it's child abuse. I've actually been talked to them on the internet. My word. These people.
Is but there actually?
Yeah.
What about when they're grown-ups and nobody does it for them?
I guess.
Because we had to do chores. I mean, we did. My mom, it was just, we had a whole list of things when we were home during the day in the summer when we were off school.
Yeah.
And we had a long list and it wasn't, I mean, we just had to do it. But at the same time, I think of the things that I like go out of my way to allow my kids to do. And I'm like, they owe me.
this is
a team.
And something that we tell them often is that you are a valuable contributor to this family. Yeah. Like right. What you do matters. What you do is important. It helps keep things running well. It helps keep us from chaos. It like you're not just a cog in a machine. You and your specific contribution in this is like a way of our family motto is be a blessing, but we say that starts with our own family, you know, because it can be easy to be like, be nice to everybody else, but you know, treat your sister like her don't be self-sacrificial, open the doors for other people. No, open the doors for your sisters first or your mama. Like that's the practice, the daily kind of almost liturgy of it needs to start at home or else it's going to be A, disingenuous out in public, and B, harder to remember because you won't have the routine of it.
We tell our kids that constantly too, like, you're such a help. And I brag on them in front of other people too. I'm like,
yeah,
I mean, I don't know. We wouldn't be able to get it all done if we didn't have help, but you know, like they are valuable. They are contributors. It makes, yes, it, you know, raises your self-worth.
Yes. And also, I don't know if you've ever, ever listened or read the book, Little Britches. Are you familiar with that one? Mm-mm. So it's basically this guy's life story. He's writing it from an autobiographical perspective. And I mean, the things that they're doing at 9 years old, like feeding all the animals in the freezing cold, it's like not pioneer days, but it's kind of Wild West type of situation. And he's not, this is this guy's perspective, and he's not like, I was so angry at my mother for dumping on me and robbing my childhood. He's like,
yeah, I wish I would have had a life of leisure all growing up.
Yeah. Well, and he's like, can I ride the Bronco? Like, can I get on it yet? Am I old enough to do these? Cause he ends up doing all these amazing like horse tricks. He goes and does this cool circuit where he learns. I mean, so he's hanging off the side and his mom is afraid he's going to fall and bust his head, but he's like 12 when he's doing this. And I think there's a lot of coddling we do and a lot.
Oh, we do. And I do it too. My kids are in the tree and I'm like, get down. You're going to paralyze yourself.
I know. And there's some aspects to probably we know better than we used to. But there's also an aspect to underestimating the abilities that our children have and kind of selling them short. And I feel like the more you give your kids meaningful things to contribute, not busy work, but meaningful things that are genuinely helpful and teach genuine skills to them. Like you said, the more self-worth, the more confidence, the more ability to manage their time that they're going to have as they proceed into young adulthood. I was required to do chores, but I'm one of only, putting air quotes around that too. And we were homeschooled. And we had some friends up the road that were also homeschooled that we spent tons of time with. So I look back and I'm like, what did my mom do? Like, I can't imagine being home and having that much, you know, like we were both up at the friend's house for hours every day.
Right.
She kept the house. She's a meticulous housekeeper and she put food on the table and she did all kinds of things. I know now what she did. But I know that she probably let me get away with more than I let my kids get away with because there were quote only two of us.
She could.
She had a lot of time to do it. But I sort of regretted that coming into young adulthood, coming into young married, because I was like, I don't learn some of this stuff. Like, I need to learn how to cook spaghetti and I need, you know, I need to learn how to keep myself on a schedule. And so I know that she was a wonderful mother and I appreciate everything she did, but I wish she pushed me a little bit more, honestly.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, you can always pick up things later. I'm amazed at how much once you're motivated to pick something up that you can just, you know, nobody has to force you to do it.
Absolutely.
One of the themes you talk about on your Instagram is in regards to teenagers, because the world tells us that teens are horrible people. I get it constantly because my first is going to be a teenager in a couple of weeks.
And a girl. Oh my goodness, a girl.
Yeah. And honestly, she's going to be fine. Like she's a really good one to start into teenagers with for me. And honestly, I think the next one's going to be fine too. But what is it that the world tells us? And then how have you seen that, especially you have teenage boys? Like, I feel like you're very connected with them too. And I feel like that's going to be a little bit of a struggle. Maybe I'm wrong, but to have boys that are close to their mom as they get older.
So you're right. The world tells us that teenagers will, like, we were just at Thanksgiving and we had some relatives over and my husband made some comment to the aunt, one of the aunts, about something to do with, well, I mean, I think the assumption is that they have to rebel. And I just don't believe that that's true. And she's like, don't they? Like, isn't that like the rite of passage? Yeah. I'm like, that is the narrative that is being pushed. Yes. Mm-hmm. The narrative is that they will either gradually come to the realization that all adults, especially their parents, are complete idiots and despise them for a time. Or one day they will wake up, you know, hit that magic number and suddenly feel, 30. You know, yeah. And so I have not found this to be true. If, And I'm looking at, you asked me about me and my boys, and I'll talk about that in a second. But I like to start with other people that I'm seeing, because people say, like, oh, you're going to toot your own horn and you think you're doing so well. No, I am looking at these moms that have gone ahead, that have close relationships with their girls and their boys, with their young adults, with their married kids. And I'm saying, what did you do? What kinds of things, what kind of time did you put in? What was the, not the magic formula, but what was the effort that you found the most fruitful? Mm-hmm. And they are telling me over and over again that you consistently pour into their lives with God's word, that you don't take the easy way out when it comes to the conversations, that you don't leave the hard topics up to the world to tell them about. Do you talk about sex with them first? You talk about relationships with them first. You talk about God's truth and righteousness and holiness and what that looks like living counterculturally. That you are willing to go against the grain with technology. Huge, huge. So our approach to that with our boys, which the only two that really have any technology, is they have Apple Watches, which we use to communicate all the time. So mm-hmm. we can text back and forth when they have Wi-Fi. They don't have phone packages, but they can text with me when they have Wi-Fi, which they do at yeah. home. They have to have phones connected to those Apple Watches to be able to have that capacity. So they have a phone, like an old iPhone. Like, right. I don't even know what number, but old iPhone that they keep in our schoolroom. They're not allowed to take it to their rooms. This is not something that they're spending massive amounts of time on. They are not sending videos and pictures, and any kind of communications that they do, they check with us first. Hey mom, my, you know, this sounds so holy, but it's actually true. My Bible study group, as we started Bible study group, my Bible study group is getting on GroupMe. Can I have a GroupMe with just that group? Yes, you can have a GroupMe with that group, you know, but are you just on GroupMe kind of off in the wild? No,
right.
You know,
yeah.
And so there's that kind of check and balance. And as they've gotten older, there have been a couple of times we've had to rein things in, or a couple of times we've been like, ah, sure, you can do that for you. You've shown yourself responsible. You've shown yourself. And we reserve the right to take their phone and look at any communications that they have. So, you know, we'd like to see your texts. And mm-hmm. they hand them over without fear, because they know that it could happen at any time. And there's only a select number of people they're texting anyway. There's no pictures going back and forth, you know, things like that. So setting those boundaries with technology. Another one would be social media. I mean, it makes sense that they're not on social media because they're not doing a ton with technology anyway. But when I say that, people are like, wait a minute, you're on social media. I'm like, yes, but I'm a 39-year-old mother.
Right.
There's a difference. Yes. Between a 14-year-old boy and a 39-year-old mother. Am I going to tell my kids they can't have social media when they're 22? Of course not. You know, like,
yes, at that point you've laid the groundwork and they can do what they want to.
Yeah. Yeah. And so I think just keeping those open lines of communication, making sure that they know that the Bible is the standard for truth. And that's where we're going over and over again. Like, your friend does this, your friend says this, what does scripture have to say about that? And having that not be a weird thing. If you start that at 13, it might be weird. If you started at 3, by 13, they're like, the Bible says this, and I get it. I understand why. Mm-hmm. Not that their attitude is perfect every time, because guess what? Mine isn't either.
Yeah. I mean,
this expectation that we're going to have like perfect kids when we ourselves will wake up with snitty right. attitudes, you know, or yeah. lazy or whatever, is ridiculous. But that you can actually have an enjoyable kid who loves the Lord and on his own makes good decisions because you, as you said, you've laid the groundwork. That is entirely possible. Absolutely.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, like the scripture says, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. You don't even have to necessarily know exactly how to explain it. You know, right. it'll interpret itself, you know.
Exactly. Yeah, it cuts through. It does.
Yeah.
You talk about connection with my boys. I think just paying attention. I think mm-hmm. I just like one way that Ezra and I communicate via school, because he's very self-sufficient at this point. He's actually a junior. He's okay. young. He'll be 16 in May, but he's a junior. And so he's very self-sufficient with his work. He's very self-motivated. He keeps up with his own assignments. I mean, I did the same. I started college at 15. My mom was not checking my assignments. I was doing my own assignments, you know.
Yeah.
I knew what was due when. And she had, as you say, laid the groundwork for me to be able to do that. So that's kind of how we've gone forward with our school, that at a certain point, yes, I am checking, yes, I'm helping, but I'm not doing it for you. I'm not reading, and we read aloud, but I'm not reading your assignment to you. You can, you know,
you can
help. If you need help with organization, I'll be happy to do that, but you're there. And so he is in writing classes, and this writing teacher that he has does not play. These are complicated theses that he has to do. And so I am, writing is my jam. That's my thing. I was an English major. My mom has a master's in English. And so being able to sit down and be like, Hesher, you're doing so much better in this. And I want to develop this idea. And he loves grammar and he loves language. And he took my Spanish class when I taught at homeschool co-op, and just rocked it because his brain works like mine does for language. And so we communicated a lot in our, like, just being wordy nerds, you know?
Right. Yeah.
And then Simon is very physical. So we see us doing our shuffle dances together, right. And they both love to play ping pong. And, you know, the other day, like, they're so mature for their age in a lot of ways. I sound like I'm bragging, but it's just true. They're just kind of old for their age, and and they were like, hey mom, you know, daddy's gone on a work trip, can we play Mario Kart with you? And I was like, heck yeah, let's play Mario Kart. So it's, you know, it's fun when they do things like that. So
yeah,
I don't mind it to be complicated if you're paying attention.
Right, you're just there and you're involved.
Yeah
One of the questions I got, which, that whenever you said they're not, the reason you're on social media is you're a 39-year-old woman. Somebody asked me, well, do your kids ever ask if they can go to school? And if so, how do you handle it? And I think it's along those same lines. They're just simply not wise enough to make that decision. You know, my kids haven't asked that, but if they have, it wouldn't change what my husband and I have decided. You know, it's why
kids
have parents.
Let me tell you about this friend of mine. Her name is Susan. She has 9 kids. Her youngest is 7, but he was kind of surprised. She had him when she was 48. And so I know.
That's a story all on its own.
Yeah. So she has like a 28-year-old and a 7-year-old, and 9 total. And so she said our firstborn egged us to go to school. She wanted to be there. She wanted to go to this private school, and she wanted to be in there with her friends. And she said, we said no for her. Because, well, like, this was like high school. She'd already been homeschooled up to a certain point. We said no for her because we knew that she struggled so much with succumbing to peer pressure that she would be right there in the middle trying to gain favor with her peers and, you know, compromising her standards.
Right.
Whereas another one of our children absolutely was grounded by age 14 in what he believed. He was a totally different personality. And he wanted to play a sport in school, and they sent him to school. And she said the older daughter, who is their oldest kid, has now come back and thanked them and said, Mom, you knew.
You're right. Yeah.
You were right.
You knew
I'm so glad you didn't put me in that environment because I would have been in a position to fail. I just struggled already with wanting so badly to be liked. Whereas this other kid was like rock steady. Like, it didn't bother him at all.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes. And as parents, that is your thing, like, to be able
job.
To,
it's your
yeah,
job.
It's your job.
Yeah,
exactly.
Absolutely.
What is your motivation to do it all? This person says they just don't have the motivation. And I feel like partially things get easier the more you get used to it. You know, you've been a mom for 15 plus years. I've been a mom for 13. And at first, the things that were really hard, now it's just like, I can knock it out, no problem.
Yeah. And yeah, man, oh my goodness. I think we literally talked this through pretty hardcore the last time we talked, and people told me it was one of the most encouraging things.
Oh, you're right. It. Yeah, I'll definitely.
No, I mean, I'm happy to, like, to kind of reiterate, because I feel like this is really huge, that there is an idea. And I feel like it's kind of one of the things I talk about with, MisforMama, a rebellion against mediocre motherhood, is this idea that we are to stay stagnant, that things are supposed to stay just as hard always. I think that the hard changes, and you know that I always say hard is not the same thing as bad, because one of the main things that hard things do for you are grow you and push you and force you to reevaluate and change and hopefully do it better next time. And so this idea that we stay stagnant, that every child that we have, regardless of whether it's 1, 2, whatever, 10, 19, that somehow when we encounter these same things, we're going to have the same hangups. I think that's shortchanging the gospel, because the Bible literally says, he who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. And so we have to believe that in motherhood too, right? So I agree. People get upset when you say, it does not bother me even a little bit to go to the grocery store with all children now, like baby. It's because I have so much under my belt of, this is kind of what I need to be prepared for. This probably the meltdown probably will happen if we go at this time of day. Let's avoid that time of day, you know? Just kind of some practical things, or I need to make sure that I have a snack in my purse. You know, I need to make sure that that we don't wear the scratchy pants that drive this particular kid crazy, you know? And so you kind of, it's part of that paying attention thing and just staying, maybe not on top of everything. There's always going to be something that's a little bit of a mess.
Well, I feel like even if the meltdown happens, I can deal with it better. I'm just like,
yes. Yeah.
It's a meltdown. Yeah. Like I'll make it out of the store. We'll make it home. Exactly. The groceries will be put away. The kid will be sleeping. I can see the light at the end of the tunnel. Later today, this won't be such a problem.
Yes. I think that is one of the biggest encouragements I want to give young moms or any mom that's struggling, is if you can think in terms of whatever you're struggling with being only for a season, whether it's 4 hours or 4 months.
Right. Exactly.
Almost nothing lasts forever.
I think that's what makes it so much easier just in general. Like we have, you know, right now, I think, I hardly know. I'm pretty sure every day for the last week, my 3-year-old's been he's four now, waking up at 5 a.m. When my oldest did that, because they all go through phases like that.
Yeah.
Like, oh my gosh, we're waking up at 5 a.m. How do I fix this? And I'm just like, oh, did he wake up at 5 a.m.? Oh, no. Yes. You know, it's just a thing you go through, and then you don't anymore, and you go through it again, you don't, and you always survive.
Yeah.
And it's just not that you always survive.
That's right.
Yeah. So I just look back. Our last episode was episode 80. So if you absolutely loved this conversation, you can go back to episode 80 and listen to us chat for however long we chatted last time about similar topics, but I'm sure we said it differently because it was about a year ago. So I don't remember exactly when we recorded that one, but yeah. So Tom, tell us more about your book and where we can, oh my gosh, our last one was December 17th. That is too funny. I didn't even realize we were planning it in the same month.
Yeah. Well, I remember that I had baby twins. And we tried to record, and like I was trying to do it in the car, and normally they were asleep, and they were like,
so you knew about what month. See, I have one baby, so it's easy. You just nurse them and
But you were absolutely illustrating the point that you just made. Probably if this were your first, no way would you do a podcast while nursing a baby. You would be like,
I'd be like, I need a babysitter. I'm trying to do a podcast. Exactly. Okay. I have somebody watching the other ones. That's important. Exactly. But the baby?
I've got this. So yes, it was right out a year ago. And I can honestly say that I'm considerably less stressed than I was a year ago. Yes,
I bet you are. With 1-year-old twins, not babies.
Yes. And book deadline. I had book deadline last year. So it was like, it was due like January 1st, and Christmas and babies and all the things. It was wild ride, but we made it. Like I said, nothing lasts forever. We made it. I got it done. More about the book. Okay. So you can get it just about anywhere. I think I like christianbook.com, Books A Million.
Yeah. I Googled it this morning, and the first thing that came up was Christian Books. So
Which would be a great one to support, because they are just a godly source of resources, and I love them. You could even get it on little, like people were telling me they could get it on little independent online things. I can't remember the name of the one that someone was telling me that they found that had like UK shipping, but you can actually get it in the UK. Because quite a few people were asking me from Ireland and England, and like, oh, I won't be able to get it. And they're like, no, you can. It may be on the slow boat, but you can get it. So pretty much anywhere you can get a book, you should be able to get this, which is awesome, which is so exciting.
I know, this is exciting. So the book is M is for Mama, A Rebellion Against Mediocre Motherhood, coming from Abbie Halberstadt, mother of 10, 2 sets of twins, I'm positive it's going to be a good one.
Thank you so much.
All right, well, thank you so much for listening to this episode of the Simple Farmhouse Life podcast. If you're a mom, I hope that you found it encouraging. I know that you probably did based on the feedback I got from the last episode that I did with Abbie. Make sure to go check out her book. Just search MisforMama, it'll come up and you can get it from your preferred bookseller. As always, thank you so much for listening, and I'll see you in the next episode of the Simple Farmhouse Life podcast.